This video is going to be about some of the tools. I kind of made assumptions that you might have some basic flashlights and screwdrivers laying around, so I didn't put them in the first tools you'd want to get for being a professional mechanic. But this video is going to go a little more in depth into the next level of tools you're going to need. You're going to want to upgrade to some professional level tools, and that's what we're going to talk about in part two. Hey guys, thanks for tuning in to Making It Work. I'm Jimmy. If you haven't been here before, welcome back to the channel if you have been. I did a video last week about the first tools that someone aspiring to be a mechanic should buy, starting with the general basics. I'll put a link to that video up here somewhere. So if you guys haven't seen the part one, you'll want to check that out first before you even watch this video probably. So if you haven't seen that video, go ahead and check it out. And then we're going to get into this video, part two, tools that someone would need if they're aspiring to be a professional mechanic. Let's get into this video. Some of the first things that an aspiring mechanic is going to need, if you don't already have some basic screwdrivers and flashlights and things like that that you could have used to start out, you're going to want to pick some of those up first. Doesn't really matter. I use a Snap-on flashlight a lot, and I use a Streamlight flashlight a lot. Very expensive, actually. I mean, both of these are great tools. If you have the budget to pick up one of these, I highly recommend the folding Snap-on flashlight. I have a video just about flashlights. This thing does a whole bunch of cool stuff. It lights up a pointer light as well as the bar lights and stuff. Really handy light. I use it a lot. It's durable. I've let a lift down on it and it still works. So kudos to Snap-on for that. I'm not sure who makes this light for them, but it's actually been a very good light. I want to say it was about $100 or so, maybe $120. I'll try to put something down in the video down below to show you exactly what it costs. I'll look it up when I edit this video. The Streamlight light, probably I go to the most because it's really handy. I can stick it in my pocket, where this light will go in your pocket, but all the rubber around it that protects it actually makes it hard to get it out of your pocket. So a lot of times you're looking around under a car, you're going to want to look at something quick. You pop this light out of your pocket. I put it in my pocket right now, and I can grab it out of my pocket and look at stuff, and I can look under a car looking for problems, under a dash, whatever it might be. So a light like the Streamlight's really handy. It doesn't have to be a Streamlight. It can be something similar. Olight makes a lot of good lights. There's several manufacturers. I mean, they're all over Amazon, even Home Depot, Lowe's. You can pick up a pretty good flashlight. I would get something that's aluminum, not plastic. Preferably something that has some rubber on the front end, maybe even rubber on the handle where you can grip it. But you don't want soft rubber like this. Like I said, the Snap-on light, it's hard to get in out of your pocket. So I mostly use this when I can set it on my cart nearby and do my deal and then put it back on my cart. It's got a magnetic base, so that helps a lot. This doesn't have magnets. It has the octagon, so it doesn't roll off your work area, whatever you're working on, which helps a lot too. But I mean, there's a ton of good lights. You could probably get a nice light for $40 or $50. This light's close approaching $200 for this light, so it's not a must for a mechanic just starting out, but you do need something similar. You gotta have a good flashlight to do the job. There's so many dark spots working under a dash, looking at down at a serpentine belt. Put a belt on a car, you're gonna want to make sure the belt's backing all the pulleys correctly before you start the engine up and risk damaging a new belt, right? So you gotta have a flashlight of some kind. But don't get like an $8 plastic junk, you know. Get something halfway decent. I'd highly recommend a metal $40 or $50 flashlight will probably do you fine. When your budget can afford it, the Streamlight and that Snap-on light are really good. One of the next tools that you would definitely need once you've got your basics is something like a test light. This is an incandescent test light. It's got a bulb in it. So when you use this to test the circuit, obviously you're going to hook one end to ground to check for power, and you can hook this end to power to check for ground. And it'll load the circuit slightly because you're trying to light an actual light bulb. The LED test lights are great to tell you if there's power and ground, but it won't tell you if the circuit's able to flow a little bit of current. This bulb will pull like 2 or 4 tenths of an amp, maybe half an amp. It'll tell you if the circuit can do something as far as pulling current through it. So it's good to have an incandescent test light just for that reason. But the tool you really need, even more than a test light, a test light's handy because you can pull it out so easy and you can put a little bit of a load on the circuit. A voltmeter. I'm using a Snap-on voltmeter right now. This is a pretty good meter. It's called the EED, E as in Edward, E as in Edward, David Michael 525 Edward. It's a real good voltmeter. I'm not sure who makes it for Snap-on. It's not Fluke, it could be, but it's not shaped exactly like a Fluke or even similar at all. But you need a good meter. Whether it's Snap-on, Fluke, you know, again, avoid the $15, $20 meters. You need something that's going to be pretty decent. And it does matter because meters themselves have tolerances. And the better the meter is, the more accurate it's going to be when you're testing for resistance and voltage drop and things like that. So I would highly recommend a good meter. This does up to Cat 2 750 volts AC. You can test all kinds of things using this meter, not amperage. You don't want to put amperage through the meter because it'll blow the fuses. There's fuses inside under this cover. You don't want to use this test for amperage. You can test for voltage though. This is only going to show you voltage. The voltmeter is going to help tell you all kinds of things. A test light is going to tell you if you're able to take a little bit of load through the circuit, but a voltmeter is going to tell you a lot. You can watch the voltmeter switch even on a frequency circuit, something that's controlled with Hertz. HZ is frequency. The voltmeter is going to be able to show you that. You'll be able to watch it. Like this has a graph in the bottom of the meter and you'll watch it go jumping back and forth, so you know that it's duty cycling. It's not the best method, but it is a great quick way to look at stuff. When you're working on a flat rate, you want everything to be fast and easy. You're not going to be busting out picoscopes and hooking up 17 different wires to all kinds of stuff like you might see on some of the YouTube videos. You're going to want to get in there, figure it out, and move on to the next thing. So a voltmeter is great for that. You can check batteries. You can check charging systems. You won't know things like total amperage output of an alternator, but you'll know if it's charging with a voltmeter. If you stick a voltmeter on there, it's at 13.8, 13.9 or more, then it's charging. If you want to see the total capacity of an alternator, how much it can put out, then you're going to need more expensive equipment that the shop you work at should have. Voltmeters are great for checking all kinds of things. You can put a voltmeter on the battery terminal, and you can put it on the ground cable on the engine block. And if the voltmeter shows you voltage, that's voltage drop. That means the meter is carrying voltage through to make a better connection than the wire can from the battery terminal to the block. So if the meter reads voltage, if you have the negative on the negative post of the battery and the positive on the negative cable at the block, and it reads, say, 3 volts, then you have 3 volts of voltage drop because the meter is telling you the cable is not able to carry full battery voltage through it, so the meter is picking it up. So that's a great reason to have a voltmeter. And there's all kinds of circuits that'll have voltage drop. Blower circuits, air conditioning control circuits, mostly battery cable grounds and even battery power. I've seen battery cables with a positive to the starter has 3, 5, 8 volts of voltage drop and it cranks slow. But it's not because of a bad starter or a bad battery, it's because of a bad connection and a positive cable. And if you hook your meter on it and you go from the positive to the starter and you see a whole bunch of volts on your meter, then you know you got voltage drop and your problems in the connection or the cable is a problem. So a voltmeter is really important to have. I'll try to do a video about electrical a little bit more and explain some of that stuff in depth. Trying to do the, incentivize some people to become mechanics. I think a lot of people are getting discouraged about being mechanics, and even mechanics are trying to discourage people because it can be a pretty frustrating job. I want to make these videos to let people know that every job can be frustrating. And being a mechanic is very rewarding. You can make a very good living. You'll be able to fix all your own stuff, help out family members and friends when they need it. You know, there's a lot, and you can make some good money. Most good mechanics make between $60,000 and $150,000 a year. I'm not here to discourage people from being mechanics. I am realistic, and I'm going to tell you the real problems I see and the things we need to work on. It can be frustrating sometimes, but I've had other jobs, I've tried other trades, and I always come back to being a mechanic because I make the most money, and I realize that it's stressful and troublesome sometimes in other careers as well. So anyway, back to these tools. Another thing you're going to need, I didn't put this in the first video because, I mean, most people are going to have a hammer laying around in their house, their garage, or they can borrow a hammer from their dad or someone's got them. But once you're tired of borrowing tools and you've got all your impact sockets and extensions and ratchets and things we talked about in part one, in part two, you're going to need hammers. So, I mean, this happens to be an old Craftsman hammer from days gone by, back when they were all made in USA. Craftsman hammer. You're putting hubcaps back on cars. You're not going to want to use your pickle juicers and smash hubcaps with your hands, because then you end up with bone chips and arthritis like I have. Arthritis will probably happen anyway, but it speeds up the process. So you want a rubber mallet, something like this for putting on hubcaps, maybe knocking a wheel loose if it's stuck on a hub a little bit. A lot of times a rubber hammer will do it. Anything you want to smack something good, but you don't want to damage it. Maybe you get an alternator out of a bracket that's jammed, you can hit it with a rubber mallet to free it up. Definitely a must-have tool. That's why it's in part two. Good mechanics are always going to have a rubber mallet or a dead blow style rubber coated hammer that won't mar a surface when you hammer on it. And then you need the real serious deal, some kind of a sledgehammer. You can use a giant ball peen hammer. I got the sledgehammer at Home Depot for about $23, and that was probably about 10, 12 years ago. You can see right there, it says Stanley. Camera picking that up. Stanley tool. Come on, camera. I will block you out, and then I will pull back till you focus on my Stanley hammer. I wonder if this thing's in manual focus mode. Hang on 1 second. Oh yeah, manual focus, there it is. Now my camera's on autofocus mode and it should be able to show you my hammer. Ta-da! Stanley, bought this at Home Depot for like 23, 20, 24 bucks, maybe 22, somewhere in there. I'll try to put a link in the description if you guys are interested in this kind of stuff. I'll find it on Amazon for you and put an affiliate link that'll help out the channel. This is a great hammer. Stay away from the tool truck hammers. I mean, honestly, you can buy handles for $6 or $8. Buy this on a tool truck, it's probably $130 or something ridiculous like that. You can buy like 6 of these hammers. I bought this, like I said, 10, 12 years ago, and it's a little beat up. It's got the fiberglass handle with a steel core, so it's super durable. And I have smashed the crap out of some stuff with this thing, and it's holding up great. So I would not buy a tool truck brand hammer under no circumstances. I mean, Paul had some dead blow hammers from Snap-on. He hasn't worked as a mechanic very much. He's been in management and stuff the past 10 or 12 years, and they all crumbled in his toolbox. He took them out to use them, and they were crumbling in his hands. So it happens from all the brands. I've seen some people degrading the stuff that's not made by Snap-on that does that, but they all do it. It's the material they're using to coat the dead blow hammers that it dry rots, and it doesn't matter who makes it, it's going to dry rot over time. Some might dry rot faster than others. I mean, I'm sure a $20 hammer is not going to be as good as a $130 hammer, but the $130 hammer in my mind should never give you that kind of trouble. They ought to find some kind of magical science to make something that costs 8 times as much last better. One of the other things you're going to need in part 2 is going to be clip tools for pulling door panels and clips. A lot of these Hondas and Toyotas, especially, every brand has little plastic clips holding some panels on. So you're going to need to get in there and find ways to get those little things apart. And a pocket screwdriver is great too. If you're any tool guy, if you bought your sockets and extensions and ratchets and stuff from any tool guy that comes in, if you bought anything from them, even some used stuff they might have had, they're going to give you a pocket screwdriver for Christmas. And you can buy pocket screwdrivers for a couple dollars. You can check out JDT Co. His YouTube channel, he sells little pocket pry bars. It's got a little bend in the end, and they're a little more durable than a regular pocket screwdriver. A little expensive. I think they're $23 for 3. Highly recommend those. They're cool little tools if you have the $23 to spend on a pocket pry bar. But anyway, these little tools are. I mean, I use them almost every day. If I do a window regulator, if I work on a radiator, sometimes headlights. You got to take bumpers off these cars for headlights nowadays. And you got to have these tools to pop out the, you see how that works right there? This goes underneath. You put it in between a little plastic clips and pop them out. This is good for taking trim off a dash. All it is a plastic stick. And I bought both of these, came in a set. I think I paid like 18 or 20 bucks for a set of plastic trim tools. And it came with the metal one for the more stubborn clips in that set. And I'll put a link down in the description for that as well. Level 2, also, I think I mentioned screwdrivers. You guys are going to definitely, you can start out with some screwdrivers you have around the house or something some friends or dad has or whatever. That'll be fine. Doesn't really matter what brand they are. They're going to work. All you're really doing with a screwdriver is hose clamps and things like that. Maybe prying a valve cover off a cylinder head to get to when you're doing valve cover gaskets and things like that. So screwdrivers come in handy, and cheap ones work okay. If you really want to do good, I mean, I'm using Snap-on screwdrivers right now. Super, super expensive. I mean, $180, $280, depending on how big and complete the set is, you can spend some serious money for Snap-on screwdrivers. All the tool truck brands are going to be on the higher end, and they're going to be a little bit better. But honestly, I mean, a lot of the tool trucks nowadays, the manufacturers are kicking them back if there's marks on here that show it was used as a chisel and things like that, or a pry bar. So they may not even warranty it for you. It's possible. If you have a good relationship with your tool dealer, then they're going to look the other way and just give you another screwdriver. Actually, what Snap-on does now is they pry the metal part out and press it into your old ratty handle. They don't give you a whole new screwdriver. They just give you the tip. You'll spend $180, $200 for a set of screwdrivers. And when you do chip the corner, they're going to give you just the blade and not the whole handle. That's something to think about too. So, you know, consider looking at a set like gear wrench screwdrivers or I think Sunex and Tecton, even like the Harbor Freight, Pittsburgh and Icon, they all have screwdriver sets. I mean, honestly, number two, a number four, a flathead quarter inch, and maybe a flathead 3/8, and then your pocket screwdrivers. That's basically all you're gonna need. If you've got the two main Phillips and the two main flatheads, you're gonna be covered. It's starting to rain pretty hard. And then the last tool I'm gonna put as a tier two tool that we should get to be aspiring mechanic is gonna be a bit driver. This is a Snap-on again. I've got a lot of Snap-on tools. And this has a rocker switch. A lot of people don't like the rocker switch, can't stand the rocker switch, but I kind of like it. I've gotten used to it now, so you don't have to stop and click something to the side and click it back to the side. You can just, top is in and bottom is out. I've gotten used to it. But any kind of a power bit driver, and you can put a decent bit driver, has this quarter inch chuck on it, and you can put Phillips and flathead screwdriver tips in that. And you can also obviously put quarter drive sockets on it. You know, this is just basically the same as a quarter drive ratchet. So it's definitely a good thing to use your fingers and hands as little as possible. You know, if you break something loose with a wrench or a ratchet, then you get your little quarter drive impact driver tool and spin that bolt out or clamp out with that power tool, and you're going to save your pickle juicers for the long haul. Really important, guys. I can't stress that enough, that using your hands for smacking and banging and punching hubcaps on and prying, I mean, it's all real manly and it's convenient and probably a little quicker. Take a few minutes to grab a tool. I don't think I brought any pry bars out here. Let me see. Let me get a pry bar and show you guys real quick. All right, that's the last thing in this video. It's going to be some form of a pry bar. I got these off the Mack truck, and they're probably about 10 or 12 years old. They had a nice rubber two-tone coating on there, but they make that rubber so soft that over time it softens and starts to peel and rip off. I mean, even the electric tools, the rubber's a little too soft and it starts to peel off. I bought a new case for this screw gun because it was so nasty and I couldn't stand it anymore. I think it was like $27 to get a new case for it. But anyway, the rubber on these pry bars, I wish they'd make it a little harder, or get a pry bar that doesn't have any rubber on it. Get one that's just all plastic and it's really hard plastic, preferably with an impact end on it so it's made to be hammered. Because sometimes a pry bar, you're gonna whack that thing with this sledgehammer. Really important. So that's basically, this kind of goes in the screwdriver category, but it's the last tool I'm going to put in part two here for you guys. Quick rundown. I'm going to lower the camera and show you guys my quick overview here. Basically, you know, between the screwdrivers, pry bars, some type of hammers. It's really raining now. Some type of pry sticks and clip tools, which these are pretty inexpensive. Electrical test equipment like a simple test light and a voltmeter. Doesn't have to be too expensive. Power tool of some kind, bit driver or quarter inch tool that you can adapt. Handy because of the screwdriver bits or small sockets will fit on that. And then a premium grade flashlight, a little bit better than what you might have around the house. And then you guys will be you'll have all your level two tools. So that's going to do it, guys, for part two of the tools an aspiring mechanic's going to need to do this job on the professional level. You've probably checked out part one right now if you looked at my link that I put up earlier. Now we've gone through part two, and we're getting pretty close to having almost everything you'll need as far as the basics go. You're going to need some kind of a small cart and some other things that we'll go over in part three. And we'll try to get that video up for you guys next week. So I appreciate you guys watching this video, part two. I hope you got something from it. I'm trying to do what I can to try to help some aspiring mechanics get into this business and make a good living. You'll be able to take care of your family pretty well as a mechanic. You got to be patient, and you got to be able to be a little bit of a psychologist, a therapist, a fortune teller, an engineer, and a mechanic. And you got to also be a little bit compassionate, and you'll be really successful. It's easy. All right, guys. I appreciate you watching this video. You guys are awesome. I hope you're doing great. The week's going great. Everyone's doing well in my family. I hope you guys, your families are doing good too. Life is good right now, right? I hope it is for you guys. So thanks for watching, making it work. Appreciate you guys watching.